Hello, and welcome to the C19 Weekly. I'm your host, Nicholas Tatonetti, a professor in the Department of Biomedical Informatics at Columbia University. Each week, we go over some of the latest and most interesting stories around SARS-CoV-2 COVID-19 research, with a focus on data science and bioinformatics. This is for data scientists and bioinformaticists and lovers of data science and bioinformatics everywhere. We will try to create a snapshot of what's happening right now, not a comprehensive review of all of the monumental literature that's coming out each week. In this week's topic, we're going to take a step back from data science specifically and look at the field as a whole. There are some big safety concerns for hydroxychloroquine and not a lot of evidence of efficacy. So we're going to dive into one of those studies that came out this week and the data that it provides. We're going to look at a randomized controlled trial, preliminary results from the study of remdesivir, the antiviral that was recently approved and under emergency declaration from the FDA. We're going to take a look at this fascinating autopsy of an outbreak where a few doctors from a South African hospital investigate what were the causes and sources of an outbreak at their hospital. We're going to also look at this news feature from the New York Times that looks at the risk of COVID-19 and how it compares to other risky activities. First, the safety of hydroxychloroquine. Hydroxychloroquine or chloroquine with or without macrolide for treatment of COVID-19. A multinational registry analysis. Meira et al. Published in The Lancet, May 22nd, 2020. The goal of this study was to evaluate the safety of hydroxychloroquine by itself or in combination with other drugs. They used an observational analysis of registry data, which is data that gets collected from hospitals for various reporting purposes all around the world. Although we don't know exactly where these data are coming from. They are analyzing data from 671 hospitals around the world. The main result that they find is that hydroxychloroquine is associated with significant increased morbidity and mortality, up to 1.2 to 5 times fold increase in risk. Those are pretty big numbers, and so we're going to dive into the data to see if they support that. My conclusion is that any observational data set, any registry analysis like this has the potential for huge systematic biases. And so those results should be taken with a grain of salt, even if they are very large and have 100,000 patients like this one has. I'd like to see more breakdowns of this data, but there are some interesting concerns, especially around arrhythmia where the data look a little more solid. Let's dive in a little bit deeper. So here's all they give you for in terms of the study setup. They have about 100,000 patients from the 671 hospitals that where they have access to registry data from. Where exactly do these data come from? Who exactly are these 671 hospitals are not shared, and I haven't heard of people being able to get access to that. Obvious flags. We'd like all that data to be open and public, maybe not completely public because it is patient data and should be protected and kept private. We at least should know a little bit more information about where these data are coming from. This is one of their main results, where they do one of these, what are called multivariate regression models, and estimate the risk when you take into account everything else. Their main result is here in hydroxychloroquine, and you can see there's this safety signal. To the right of this line means that there's an increased risk of mortality, and to the left of this line means that there's a decreased risk of mortality. Now, there's a couple of concerns that I already see jumping out at me. I've looked into this analysis of looking at ACE inhibitors. Now, people thought maybe ACE inhibitors would be protective because they're inhibiting the activity of the protein that the virus uses to latch onto the cell. And if they're blocking that protein, maybe they're blocking the virus too. And we have seen some studies come out that purport this. But I've looked at our own data at Columbia University and I've seen dubious results. Depending on how you analyze the data, you get completely conflicting results from one showing risk to another showing protection to many of the models showing no effect at all. So the fact that they're finding this here instantly makes me worried about bias. Now, the other thing is their hydroxychloroquine patients are possibly maybe just sicker than everyone else. We also see an increased risk for mortality when we look at our data naively, but we think that it's likely due to those patients being the sickest patients, and basically doctors are doing everything they can to save them. And so that might include using a drug that otherwise doesn't have a lot of evidence. Maybe it's only a sliver of evidence, but they're willing to try it with the patient's consent. They're willing to try some of these more experimental procedures. And so this could be because of that. I'm not convinced it's not. They do say this though, which does mitigate that concern a little bit. They say that patients must be on this treatment within 48 hours of admission. Now, that helps a little bit because maybe they're not being admitted, they're there for a very long time, and then they deteriorate, and you throw any drug you can at them. What it means, but it still does not completely account for this bias, because patients who are admitted maybe at admission state, they were much sicker, could be more likely to receive these treatments. I'm not seeing any propensity score matching models, which is what I'd like to see, where you match people compared based on these types of risks. And so that makes me a little concerned. This model, however, the arrhythmia outcome model, looks a little bit better calibrated to me. You see a lot of things that don't have an effect. Most often things don't have an effect. And so this is a reassuring plot. And you do see that there are significant risks associated with exposures to hydroxychloroquine and its combinations. This is a little bit stronger to me. I think it deserves further follow-up. And in the absence of evidence of real strong efficacy, perhaps there are better drugs to use. Gets us on to this next one, randomized placebo-controlled trial of remdesivir. Remdesivir for the treatment of COVID-19, preliminary report. Bagel et al. Published in the New England Journal of Medicine, May 26, 2020. The goal of this study was to evaluate the effectiveness of remdesivir for the treatment of COVID-19, SARS-CoV-2 infection. And the method that they used was a randomized placebo-controlled trial. This is the state of the art. This is the gold standard method of proving that a drug can actually work. The results was they found a median improved recovery time of 4 days for the patients who are exposed to remdesivir versus those on placebo control, and a reduction of the 14-day mortality from 11.9% to 7.1%. This is preliminary data. They're doing this trial in a few different phases, and this is just the first phase of data. But this is pretty promising. Treatment seems to work better for less severe cases. Exactly why that is not clear. It could just be the numbers are better for cases within a certain window. Maybe not the most severe, maybe not the least severe, somewhere in between. And most of the trial sites that were reported here from North America, you'll see in the data that if you just look at stratified analysis by other regions, they would not find a significant effect. You need North America. It's not that concerning, except when it comes to population heterogeneity. We don't necessarily know if this will work for everyone. We need more study to see other populations and if this drug will still work. This is the main output of that trial. This is a hazards analysis or a survival curve. It basically shows you the effectiveness of a particular treatment. Here in the blue line shows how many people this treatment, the number of days rather, that it took to recover from the infection, and stratified by whether or not they took the treatment, remdesivir versus placebo, in red. And you can see that the patients recovered faster if they were on remdesivir. And this is true across the different types of analyses that they run, but you can see that for patients not receiving oxygen and patients receiving oxygen, we see pretty significant effects. We don't see as strong of a difference for these higher risk or more severe cases. Again, it could be because of just smaller numbers. This is a plot that shows the overall hazards analysis that they did, very similar to that one that we looked at from the previous study. But again, this one's from randomized control data. What you see is that there are a lot of subgroups that benefit from this trial. You can also see that effect of North America really kind of bringing up the numbers, and most of the effect that we're seeing is from those patients in North America. It works equally well for men and women. There is a little bit of an age bias, perhaps again because of the severity problem. You see that patients under 40, between 18 and 40, are seeming to get the most beneficial effect from this treatment. More data is really needed for all of this analysis, but you see some interesting trends here that you'd like to see followed up on and replicated in future studies. All right, autopsy of an outbreak. This is a really fascinating report put out by this South African hospital that, if you're interested in types, it's almost written like a mystery, a medical mystery novel. And it's really interesting, a little dry maybe at times, but really interesting in the content it provides. I'll go through a little bit of here and I encourage you to read the whole thing. Report into nosocomial outbreak of coronavirus disease 2019 at Netcare St. Augustine's Hospital. Lessels, Musa, and de Olivier, self-published May 15th, 2020. So the goal here was to report on the results of an investigation of the outbreak that occurred between March 9th and April 30th, 2020 at St. Augustine's Hospital in Durban, South Africa. The method was investigative medicine, almost an investigative journalistic technique. The result was the outbreak of 119 patients was from a single patient who visited the emergency department on March 9th. And the conclusions, while there are several, I'll go through a couple of their lessons learned. This virus moves very quickly and is very difficult to track. This was the overall infections and the case rate across South Africa to give you a sense of kind of when this study was going on and what the background, what was happening in South Africa at the time. These are the methods that they used to investigate this outbreak of 119 individuals at their hospital. They reviewed medical files, laboratory records, radiological images of all of these patients. They reviewed inpatient electronic tracking system, which must map where patients are in the hospital and when they get transferred between locations to determine the movement of cases within and between wards. They reviewed staff records to see who was working at the time, who was changing shifts, when did they change shifts, who did they visit, who did they take care of. They went through the emergency department just to understand, like, what was the patient flow? Where are the possible interactions where this virus could have spread? They toured the inpatient wards that were all affected. They did a review of the operational manual. So what is the practice of medicine like at this hospital? What are the rules and regulations and policies? And they did telephone interviews of doctors, and they discussed with practitioners and managers. So this report is filled with interesting data. Data about who was infected and when they were infected, the times that they were infected, whether or not they were staff or a patient, and really interesting graphs. They have these maps of the different floors that are affected, that were affected, the wards that were affected. They can trace who was infected and which bed they were in, likely source. This is a reconstruction of the timeline of events that they were able to put together through this investigation. They put all of these different timelines together, one for each ward that they studied, and the list goes on, and you could check those out. Their main hypothesis here was that there was a single introduction of SARS-CoV-2 into the hospital, and they provide phylogenetic evidence or genetic analysis of the virus to support that hypothesis. They also identified the likely introduction event, and they also note that all but just one of the cases can be explained by this hypothesis. And that case was a 44-year-old male who was diagnosed with tuberculosis, treated for tuberculosis and recovered from it, and was tested on April 1st for SARS-CoV-2 and came up positive. There was then two later tests that were done, both came up negative. The investigators actually think that this was likely, the first result was likely a false positive test. False positive tests aren't that common with these PCR tests, but they are possible. You never know what could happen there. So it's a pretty interesting read. I encourage you, if you like medical mysteries, this is a fun one to follow them on. They had some important lessons learned. Virus spreads fairly quickly. There are several opportunities they identified where they could have probably mitigated the progression of the outbreak. And they list out some opportunities for improved policies and procedures for the future. All right, this study from the New York Times, trying to put the risk of COVID-19 in terms of mortality into context. It's an interesting, very quick read, 5 minutes on your phone. I encourage you to take a look at it. And it compares risk of COVID-19 mortality to the risk of other types of behaviors that could be deemed high risk. So putting the risk of COVID-19 in perspective by Roberts, New York Times, May 22nd, 2020. The goal here is to get a sense of what the risk of COVID-19 is compared to other activities. Method is journalism. Result is that a typical American has about a 1 in a million chance, which is also called a micromort, a 1 in a million chance of dying on any given day for any given reason, unrelated to COVID-19. And a New Yorker, they found, experiences 50 micromorts, or 50 chances in a million of dying due to COVID-19. Now, there's a lot of caveats that go with that. It depends on which population you are and how at risk you are and your exposure and your behaviors. So take that all with a grain of salt, but leave it to say that overall, on average, there's an increased risk of dying because of COVID-19, not a surprise. The conclusion is that the risk of dying, or my conclusion from reading this news feature, risk of dying from COVID-19 is somewhere in between riding a motorcycle and serving in the armed forces. And that's all we have for today. We're going to take a little break from our weekly COVID-19 reports. Please let us know what you like about it, what you'd like to see in the future, what types of investigations or reports you'd like to see. We're going to be active on our community page, on our YouTube channel, but we're going to take a little hiatus and a little break to re-energize. So thank you all for kind of coming along with us in this journey. It's been a lot of fun. And I'd like to thank, of course, my executive producer, Scott, who's been making this all happen every week, and all of you for tuning in. Thank you. Bye.